Okay, let's talk about sex, ladies and gentlemen. Though specifically, I'm going to be talking mainly about sexual assault. We all know that sex makes people do irrational things, but it also seems to make for irrationality in public policy, in part the subject of this panel. To be sure, no area of public policy has ever been completely dominated by clear-eyed thinking. Still, the kinds of moral panics that periodically grip the nation in connection with sex seem to be in a special category, from the so-called white slavery scare of the early 20th century to the McMartin preschool scandal of the 1980s, and I think it even made it into the 1990s even. Remember when we used to prosecute grandmothers for sexual assault of children based on all too obvious fantasies of those children? And now we have rash accusations of rape culture on campuses. Facts don't seem to matter when it comes to public policy concerning sex issues, and sometimes neither does common sense, as when elementary schools suspend kindergarten and first grade students pursuant to zero tolerance rules for sexual harassment, and yes, there have been a number of those too. Make no mistake, all too often it is because the federal government is leading the parade. As it becomes more intrusive, local control shrinks. When you see local schools adopting really silly policies with regard to sex, it's often because some federal policy is pushing them towards that, either requiring it, or if not requiring it, the school feels the best way to avoid problems is to adopt something that in retrospect looks pretty silly. The National Association of Scholars, of course, our primary concern is with higher education. But the problem has reached lots of other institutions too. And I wanted to discuss another one of those institutions first, just as an example. It relates, I think, to colleges and universities. 3 years ago, in a media frenzy, everyone learned the lurid truth about the United States military, or at least they thought they did, after a survey suggested that sexual assault against service women was rising dramatically. Newspapers called it an epidemic. And the New York Times in particular, I want to quote them right here, blamed all this on the rise of quote, the military's entrenched culture of sexual violence. You know, no wonder Congress feverishly proposed legislation that was supposed to deal with this scandal, including an emergency top-to-bottom overhaul of the military's criminal justice system, as proposed by Senator Gillibrand. Her since-derailed plan was to essentially dismantle the military criminal justice system, which has developed over hundreds of years to fit the unique system and the unique situation that the military is in, and she wanted to replace it with something more like the civilian system. And all this was driven entirely by the perceived failure of the military to deal with sexual assault. And as usual, there was just one problem. Precious little of the story of rampant sexual assault had any basis in fact. Contrary to what many assumed, there was no evidence that the military had a higher rate of sexual assault than other institutions like colleges and universities that have lots of young adults. Indeed, what evidence there was suggested precisely the opposite. It had less. Nor was there any good evidence that the problem was increasing. To the contrary, a sober read of the evidence showed that it was decreasing. I don't want to excuse bad behavior. It surely doesn't change the need for criminal behavior to be dealt with anything less than the full force of the law. But it does provide much needed perspective here. The military had been surveying its active duty members on sexual assault every few years since about 1988. And overall, these surveys had shown impressive improvement. Sometimes the improvement was in fact astonishing. Like the report in 2010, which showed a 35% drop in the rate of unwanted sexual contact. And parenthetically, I should say, despite what you might have read in the newspapers 3 years ago, unwanted sexual contact was actually the term that the questionnaire dealt with. And that's a very broad term, including things like touching someone on the shoulder in kind of a provocative way, not exactly what we think of when we think of rape or sexual assault, but nevertheless fits into the category. Anyway, that 2010 questionnaire had shown a 35% drop. And that probably caused the controversy that followed, because, you know, bear in mind that, you know, even expertly crafted surveys, you know, they sometimes produce inaccurate results, and the 2010 results were probably just too good to be true. And if so, the inevitable result of the next questionnaire, which came in the next round a few years later, is that it wouldn't look quite as good. And that's what happened. What was called a sudden and dramatic rise in sexual assault in the military was probably just an artifact of the fact that the previous questionnaire had come up with results that were too good to be true. So interestingly, when the military asked service women, do you think sexual harassment is more of a problem inside the military or outside the military? Well, first of all, the majority say, well, it's about the same. And of those that disagree, more of them thought that things were worse outside the military. Only 17% thought that they were actually worse in the military. That question was in their 2002 survey, and the question was dropped in later surveys because, like, good news is really not appreciated sometimes in these sorts of things. So critics often assumed that the military fails to provide sexual assault training, or that it's lax in its prosecution of these crimes relative to civilian jurisdictions. But again, the opposite seems to be true. As for training, 96% of the women and 97% of the men had reported in the 2012 survey that they had received sexual assault training in the last 12 months. The fact is that sexual assault training has been a way of life in the military for more than two decades now, possibly to the point of overkill for those who have to sit through it many, many, many times. Prosecution rate comparisons are difficult because civilian jurisdictions don't have to publish statistics of that sort. But insofar as there is evidence, it suggests the military is now more than four times more likely to prosecute a sexual assault than civilian jurisdictions. And it's not just defendants and their attorneys who are complaining about over-prosecution. It's the prosecutors, too. One female Navy prosecutor who wished to be anonymous commented to McClatchy newspapers, and I'm quoting her here, "There's pressure to prosecute," she said. Then she went on to warn of unintended consequences of over-prosecution. She said, when you get one that's actually real, there's a lot of skepticism. You hear it routinely. Is this a rape case or is this a Navy rape case? So there are a lot of troubling stories out there. I can give you one anecdote. Consider the case of two married soldiers, both of them married, not to each other, who went to a drugstore to buy what she called protection together. They checked into a hotel together, watched a little television for some reason together, and then had sexual intercourse together. Adultery is an offense that can get you thrown out of the military. They were caught and they were in trouble. Things looked not too great for either of them until she happened to undergo or participate in sexual assault training and learned that it can be aggravated sexual assault, punishable by 30 years in prison if a man has sex with a woman who's had something to drink. She then changed her story, claimed it was non-consensual, despite having told investigators earlier that she'd not been drinking, despite having told her friends that the sex was consensual, and that she wasn't sorry because her husband, she thought, had been cheating on her too. She got a promotion. Her partner in adultery was prosecuted for aggravated sexual assault. Then there's the case of three-star general Susan Helms, a former astronaut, nominated by President Obama to be vice commander of the Air Force Space Command, a very prestigious position. But she had earlier made the decision not to approve the recommended sentence for an individual under her command who had been convicted of aggravated sexual assault. Under the military justice system, and as I said, their system's very different from ours, the commanding officer has an independent duty to ensure that justice is done. It is her duty to look into the evidence. She did. She found it to be wanting. The evidence as described in the Wall Street Journal, and I didn't read the trial transcript, so I won't claim that I know the answer here, but if the Wall Street Journal was accurate, she made the right decision. The alleged victim in that case, at least from what was published in the Wall Street Journal, had consented or probably had consented to the sex. At the very least, guilt could not be proven beyond a reasonable doubt. But Senator McClaskill nevertheless put the nomination on permanent hold, arguing that Helms had sent a damaging message to survivors of sexual assault who are seeking justice in the military justice system. Obama had to withdraw the nomination, and it is doubtful that any ambitious military officer failed to take note that Helms' decision was career killing for her. As a result of incidents like that, the military's top brass has been desperate to placate members of Congress like McCaskill. A few years ago, a supplicating Army Chief of Staff, General Raymond Odierno, told the Senate Armed Services Committee that combating, and I'm quoting him here, combating sexual assault and sexual harassment within the ranks is our number one priority. Okay, the military can have many priorities, but only one can be number one. And if combating sexual assault and harassment is the military's number one priority, that means that coming up with a strategy to deal with ISIS and other threats is not. Sexual assault needs to be dealt with appropriately. It's important. But if anyone really thinks it should be the military's first priority, they need to think about that very carefully. So let's get back to the nearest concern to the National Association of Scholars, and that is sexual assault and harassment policy on campus. Last time I checked, the Department of Education had 76 open investigations into colleges and universities, including some of the largest and most prestigious universities in the nation, for supposedly tolerating sexual violence and harassment. The claim is that by failing to vigorously punish students who commit sexual assault or harassment, the schools are engaging in sex discrimination in violation of Title IX, since women are more likely to be victims than men are. Remember that Title IX is actually a very simple statute. It simply bans sexual, sex discrimination by federally funded schools. So that's very much a legal interpretation that requires quite a few steps. But as a result, these colleges and universities can have their federal funding pulled. An elaborate 2001 guidance letter from the Department of Education requires schools to take immediate action to eliminate any hostile environment, prevent its recurrence, and address its effects. Schools are, in effect, required to create an elaborate bureaucracy to deal with the threat of unwanted sexual contact or harassment. There's a lot to the 2001 guidance letter. I'm sure you've heard about it. One aspect of it that gets discussed a lot is the requirement that these schools use not the clear and convincing level of proof that was traditional among schools in deciding whether or not to expel a student, but rather a preponderance of the evidence standard. For those of you who are non-lawyers, and I assume that's like almost all of you, preponderance of the evidence is simply proving that it's more likely than not that the student under investigation has done the act that is at issue. So we're talking about just a hair over 50%. In criminal cases, you've all heard about the standard of guilt beyond a reasonable doubt, which is a much higher standard. And the clear and convincing standard, which is often used for things that are in between the civil case where someone is simply asking for damages, an injury has occurred, it's just a question of who's going to bear the loss, the plaintiff or the defendant. So we have a very low standard, preponderance of the evidence. Criminal, you want a very high standard. Clear and convincing has traditionally been used by colleges and universities for things like punishing a student. They're not going to go to jail, but they might be suspended, they might have some other thing, they might even be expelled. But the Department of Education has insisted, essentially, that schools use preponderance of the evidence. I don't think, actually, that is that terrible a thing by itself. If there were other things in the guidance letter that ensured that basic justice would be done, such as, for example, if the student had the ability to subpoena witnesses in his favor. There are a lot of other things. If the student, for example, were not going before a tribunal that is dominated by people who are, in fact, professional Title IX officers, shall we say. But in fact, they often are very, very invested in the notion that there is sexual assault rampant on campus. And honestly, you don't want somebody who is that invested in the topic to be in charge of deciding whether or not a student is expelled or not. So all of this is said to be necessary on account of an epidemic of sexual violence on campuses. Indeed, if you believe what you hear, one-fifth to one-quarter of all female college students will be the victim of actual rape or attempted rape while in college. Protecting students from sexual assault of any kind of assault, for that matter, is important. Although I would add the responsibility for the enforcement of laws against violence should fall mostly to the police and regular courts and not to colleges, and certainly not to college administrators whose jobs depend upon the continued perception that sexual assault is rampant on campus. My point is simply that these numbers exaggerate the threat and that exaggerating the threat is not a virtue. I don't have time to critique all the highly inflated empirical studies on this subject. The White House has, and President Obama himself has been quoting some of these statistics. Let me stick to the most cited among those, the cost study, which found that during a 12-month period, 16.6% of all college women have been the victims of rape or attempted rape. Of course, 73% of these women did not agree that they had been raped, and about 40% of them had had sexual intercourse with their so-called assailant again after the incident, which I think speaks volumes here. Contrast that with the sexual victimization of college women study funded by the Department of Justice in the year 2000. It found that only 1.7% of women responded that they had been raped in the past year. Of these, almost half, I've stated that wrong, they've classified 1.7 of these as rape, but almost half of those were again situations where the student herself declined to call it anything like rape. Rather, that was spin put on it by the researchers, and even those researchers, they're down to 1.7 as opposed to 16.6. Even that, less than, you know, even if you take that and divide it by two, that's still a distressingly high rate if that were really rape. But if you were thinking of stranger rape, you're thinking of the wrong things. These are mostly date rape cases, some of which are indeed clear-cut, non-consensual sex, and indeed should be punished harshly. Other of those cases are fraught with misunderstandings and moral ambiguities. I note that one of the major risk factors for rape in the sexual victimization of college women study was, as they put it, frequently drinking enough to get drunk. Unfortunately, the media have little interest in questioning the inflated numbers. Rape culture in colleges is much better clickbait than campus dating scene full of ambiguities. That's not going to get it. You probably hear stories about the eagerness with which the Department of Education wants colleges and universities to go after students who are accused of sexual assault. Swarthmore is being investigated in part because it failed to punish a male student. He and the alleged victim had been having sexual intercourse for several months and had agreed to break up. She nevertheless allowed him to sleep in her bed, and she crawled into bed with him. He took this to mean that she was willing to have one last time for old time's sake. She says she rebuffed him once, but when he tried again, she decided just to let him have his way and to get it over with. She then waited a month and a half actually, to complain of rape and was upset that no one took her seriously. There is forcible rape on campus, the kind that can only be responded to with a felony conviction, probably more than you would find in institutions dominated by older persons. But inflating the numbers is fear-mongering. And fear-mongering is not a good thing for anyone, including women. Half a century ago, colleges had a method to deal with these ambiguities. They recognized, as many psychologists do, that women, on average, register on personal inventory tests as more, quote, agreeable than men. And that women were therefore more likely to be pushed into things that they really aren't keen on being pushed into, including sex. Your grandmother knew that. Often they regret it, and sometimes they rightly feel they've been taken advantage of. So colleges used to set up rules that would head these situations off before they happened. They had women's dorms and they had men's dorms. And men weren't allowed in the women's dorms, or they weren't allowed after 8 p.m., or if they were allowed in a women's actual dormitory room, both feet of all parties had to be on the floor at all times. There were chaperones at parties. Have you heard that word recently, chaperones? Students still get themselves into sticky situations, but they have to try harder. They had to try harder to do so back then than they do now. When the sexual revolution came along, cool folks all over the country began to realize how stupid those old college fuddy-duddies were, and that everyone needed to loosen up a little bit. But you know, maybe they weren't so stupid after all. Maybe that wasn't stupid at all. What's interesting is that nobody who purports to be concerned about sexual assault on campus, no one who supports the 2011 guidance, seems to be calling for a return to the days when college students were more closely supervised and an effort was made to head off sexual improprieties before they occur. I know it still happens in some schools, but that's not what the national conversation seems to be about, and I think that's a significant point. It means that either they know they're greatly exaggerating the problems, or they really prefer to sacrifice the safety and happiness of female students for the pure joy of punishing the male students who go over the line. But let me tell you a story. My grandmother grew up in a little farm town where she was born, and at the time, it was during the period that the white slavery scare was riding high. When Americans were being told that young women in cities were being routinely snatched off the streets and forced into prostitution. My grandmother was very talented, too. She applied for admission and was accepted to Radcliffe College, then the sister school, to Harvard College. But in the end, her parents wouldn't let her go. They thought that life in the big city, and to them, Cambridge, Massachusetts was a big city, was too dangerous for a young woman. She had to stay on the farm until she was married. And of course, she married a farmer and stayed on the farm. She never forgot this. For her, people who exaggerate dangers are not heroes. They are the reason that she spent her adult life milking cows. And while milking cows can be a wonderful life for those who choose it, it was not the life that she had chosen for herself. It was a life that was forced upon her because of exaggerated fears. They are not heroes. I'm going to let it go there. And I think I would otherwise run out of time if I start to talk about the transgender guidance. But I would be absolutely happy to talk about the transgender guidance in the question and answer period.
You ready for me?
Yep.
Okay. You know, there's a solution to everything she just described. I can solve that problem. Stop having unbiblical sex. It's done. I've said on talk radio, I can cure STDs right now. I've got the solution. Stop having unbiblical sex. And we don't have to have these conversations anymore. Problem in the academy today is, when's the last time you even heard somebody suggest that from the podium, from the administration, or in any lecture hall? The obviousness of the worldview that works and the ideas that have positive consequences has been lost in our culture, in our industry. The pathology of the intellect, we think that we're smarter than everybody else, and we think we're smarter than God. We commit the original sin over and over again. We declare ourselves to be as God. We take the fruit from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, thinking that God is unnecessary any longer, and we can define it all. My land, we can even define what's male and female now. We can define and redefine gay and green and left and right and up and down and black and white and good and evil. We are as gods. That's the problem with this discussion. I am a Christian. Everything I tell you today and everything I share with you today will be shared from that context. I'm not pretending that everybody in this room is, but if you truly believe in tolerance, then tolerate me for a second. I am the guy that went on the Bill O'Reilly show during the RFRA debate in Indiana. I received a phone call in my little office in Bartlesville, Oklahoma, at Oklahoma Wesleyan University, asking if I wanted to go on the O'Reilly Factor to discuss the Religious Freedom Act in Indiana and the controversy surrounding it. At that time, I thought, why in the world are they calling me? Mr. O'Reilly actually had me on the program. By the way, the first time I had ever done that, I went down to Tulsa, Oklahoma, sat at Cox Studios with the black eye of the lens staring me in the face, no monitor, an earpiece in my ear. Mr. O'Reilly came on and said, we're going to go on in about 10, 20 seconds, and here we go. Somebody asked me afterwards, what was it like to be on the O'Reilly Factor? I said, well, it's a little bit like being thrown into the deep end of the pool and told to learn to swim. And oh, by the way, there's a shark there. You might want to attend to him, too, while you're at it. Anyway, during that debate, and I'm setting it up here just to give you context for what I'm going to share about Title IX and the Dear Colleague letter and the lunacy, the literal lunacy that is endemic in that letter. And the total lack of academic freedom and intellectual freedom, and the total imposition of the state on the local college and university. I'm going to talk about that in a second, but set up in context. When I was with O'Reilly, we actually got to the point where he kept emphasizing the issue of tolerance. And I finally got frustrated. I said, Mr. O'Reilly, on your anniversary, did you send your wife an I tolerate you card? And it was silent, which is unusual for O'Reilly. And I said, I surely hope not, because if you did send your wife an I tolerate you card on your anniversary, it probably did not end well. I said, tolerance is an inferior virtue. Christian love is superior. Tolerance says I could care less, do what you want. Love says I care deeply. Stop. Love is superior, tolerance is inferior. Love cares, tolerance is careless. So why don't we talk about love rather than tolerance in our culture today? I'm also the guy that wrote the Not a Daycare piece because I was so frustrated. I actually had a kid come forward at a Christian college after a required chapel where the homily was on 1 Corinthians 13, the quintessential love chapter. He came forward afterward and said, I was offended. I was singled out. I felt that you were going after my peers and me. My response was, if you'd rather be coddled in your selfishness and sin rather than be confronted in your character, go someplace else. We do not issue trigger warnings for altar calls. A sermon is supposed to make you feel uncomfortable. That's the point. We want you to confess your sins, not complain about trigger warnings and safe spaces and microaggressions. This is a university, it's not a daycare. Now, I write an article once a week for the local newspaper, and generally, five people read it and three people care. That particular article, believe it or not, and I still don't know to this day, was picked up by Glenn Beck on Thanksgiving morning. By Thanksgiving at dinner, 50,000 views had been on Glenn Beck's Facebook page with regard to that article. By the end of the week, it was 3,500,000. On NBC and ABC and CBS and Dr. Drew and Dreher and Drudge and Limbaugh and Beck and O'Reilly and Fox and Friends. The list went on and on. Simply because I said something that anyone could say, and I would argue should say. It's not about you being comfortable. Ideas aren't supposed to make you feel comfortable. They're supposed to challenge you, and I expect you to grow, not remain stagnant. Isn't that what good education is about, whether it's Christian or otherwise? Isn't that what your job is? To confront bad ideas with better ideas. Richard Weaver told us in, I believe it was 1948, in his seminal work, Ideas Have Consequences, that ideas have consequences. That was the point of his book. We market ideas. We are in the business of pursuing what's true, not handing out diplomas and opinions. I don't give degrees and opinions at Oklahoma Wesleyan University. I don't pat you on the back when you graduate and say, congratulations, you've got a diploma, a degree in opinions. That would be absurd. I expect them to pursue what's true and right and real and just, and to understand that to some degree over and above what they did when they came in 4 years earlier. And if somebody wants to challenge me and say, oh, that's just your opinion about education, well, if you're an engineer designing airplanes on the basis of your opinion, please tell me which airplane it is. I don't want to get in it, nor do you. And if you're a medical doctor or a nurse administering medication on the basis of your opinion, stay away from me. You're dangerous. Pol Pot and Mao and Robespierre and Chavez and Hitler and Mussolini and Stalin and Castro, all the despots of history had opinions. And it did not end well. Opinions lead to bondage and slavery. But Jesus told us, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. That's the point of education, is to pursue the truth and to help our students get a little bit more of it than they had when they started. And I don't apologize for that being my paradigm. With that as the context, I get these stupid letters from the DOE and the OCR. And they have the audacity to tell me, an evangelical, orthodox, biblical Christian who's leading a bold and unapologetic Christian liberal arts institution, that I now have to provide transgender accommodations to my students under the auspices of Title IX. Now stop and think about it. I may just be a dumb president, not a faculty member or professor. I'm just one of these dumb administrators. But even though I'm not the sharpest knife in the drawer, I think that women are real. I think that females are a biological fact. And I think Title IX assumes that, because Title IX was established to give women equal access to the athletic field. Well, how can I give women equal access to anything if you're now telling me that they aren't a biological fact, but nothing but a postmodern construct, a fabrication, a fantasy of a delusional male? They're unicorns, they're leprechauns, they're not real any longer, so take their rights away and give it to anyone who raises their hand on a given moment and says, I'm a woman, I want that shower, I want that bathroom, I want that sport. How in the world is that compliant with Title IX? Forgive my French, but it's bass-ackwards if anything was. It's upside down. It is misogynistic. It denies the woman her rights, her privacy, and her existence. So, when I got that letter, I got the Alliance Defending Freedom to send them a letter. And I said, no, I believe women are facts. We still teach science at this institution. Biology and physiology and genetics. And we believe that we should honor the science of the obvious. And you know what the response was? Okay. We got an exemption. If you hear anything out of me right now or in the next 5 minutes before I'm done, get a backbone. Have some intellectual courage. Stop letting this lunacy push you around. Let the truth win. Be classically liberal. That's why I wrote my book, Why I'm a Liberal and Other Conservative Ideas, because I believe as a conservative, I'm much more classically liberal than my progressive left-to-center counterpart, because I believe in a robust, open exchange of ideas, because the truth will judge. Not you, not me, not power, not politics, but truth will win. And that's good education. Get a backbone. Confront this lunacy, because that's what it is. Claim the high ground. I'm pro-woman. I'm the feminist. I'm defending the reality, the existence, the actual fact of the female, and you all are dumbing it down to nothing but a leprechaun. Not you all, but the government. Okay, Title IX and the, I'll give you 5 minutes on the situation where we're suing the federal government. By the way, I've sued them too for the Obamacare abortifacient mandate. We're pro-life, my land. Why do the women at Oklahoma Wesleyan have to be told by the government what contraception they will or will not buy? They're smart enough to make their own decisions, thank you. The government doesn't have to tell them to buy a product they don't want and they won't use. And by the way, the Little Sisters of the Poor are nuns. They're Catholic. They don't have sex, they're celibate. They don't need contraception, and you don't need to tell them to buy it. And nobody's standing up and defending these. Anyway. All right, so we get the Dear Colleague letter on the sexual harassment, sexual violence thing. And it basically tells me that what I've been doing for the last 20 years of my career, when I was a dean of students, now a college president, whereas if a woman or anybody else comes forward and says that they've been the victim of a crime, I immediately have done this, and it's worked forever, guys. Guess what I do? I take them to the police, because the police are trained to deal with this, and I'm not. Nor is anybody else on my campus, quite frankly. And I encourage the report. I don't brush it under the carpet. I don't try to hide it to save the reputation of the university. I take the girl to the police, and we help her file the claim, and we support her 100% of the way. And if the guy did it, he's kicked out of school. Now, we support her. But this letter tells me that I can no longer exclusively do that. See, what I'm obligated to do now is convene a kangaroo court of you guys, faculty, staff, and peers, to review this case on my campus. Now stop and think what this does to the girl. It violates her privacy. She has to drag this story in front of a bunch of faculty, a bunch of librarians and staff, and even students that are going to hear this story. It violates her privacy. I am forced to do that. It also ignores the due process rights of both parties. I can't follow due process any longer. I have to violate that. And then it makes the whole decision subject to a bunch of people who haven't been trained to deal with the litigation and adjudication of an investigation of criminal claims. This makes no sense. The preponderance of evidence versus clear and convincing evidence. So, FIRE, the Foundation for Individual Rights in Education, called me up and said, because they heard me open my big mouth a couple times, I guess, and they called me up and said, would you be interested in us representing you? I said, yes. We're the only university in the nation that said yes. We're the only one. And we are suing the federal government for the very issues that have been described. And I'm saying this, first of all, I will not violate the constitutional rights of any of my students. Second of all, I am pro-woman, I'm classically feminist, I believe that the woman's privacy should be honored. And you cannot force me to violate that. Third, we believe in clear and convincing evidence, not the preponderance of evidence. And fourth, I have no training in criminal justice, nor do my faculty, nor do my students, nor do my staff that would make us qualified to investigate or adjudicate a criminal claim. So no, we will not comply with this Dear Colleague letter. We're going to turn it over to the police, thank you, and let them do their work. That's our case.
So the floor is open to question.
I was just going to take up Professor Heriot's bait to ask her about the transgender aspect of these issues.
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay, I'll take that to mean that you want to know something about the legal aspects of the transgender issue. Well, as I said, Title IX itself simply bans sex discrimination. It won't come as a shock to you to think that when Congress passed the education amendments of 1972, that they really weren't thinking about the transgender issue, that they really didn't have in their minds the notion that gender identity is something that should be included in the definition of sex. I'm sure they weren't thinking about the issue at all. But if they had been reading up on the issue, if they'd been looking around for something to read about this issue, what they would have found is, in fact, that the word transgender was first coined in the 1960s, used a handful of times. One of the times it was in 1969 when Virginia Prince, who was a man living as a woman and who was the publisher of a magazine called Transvestia, which you probably didn't subscribe to back in 1969 because I'm sure it had a very low circulation. But she wrote, "I at least know the difference between sex and gender, and I have simply elected to change the latter and not the former. If a word is necessary, I should be termed transgenderal." Again, this is a man who dressed and acted as a woman. That's what the term gender meant at the time within the LGBT community. And you know, you go through uses of the term. I looked earnestly to find some occasion that might show that Congress could possibly have been thinking of what is now termed gender instead of sex, but no, they meant sex, the biological term, when they passed the 1972 Act. There is an exception in the Act that allows what was then the Department of Health, Education, and Welfare, and now is simply the Department of Education, to promulgate rules that would be exceptions. The exception to the rule against sex discrimination that is relevant states that a recipient of federal funds may provide separate toilet, locker room, and shower facilities on the basis of sex, but such facilities provided for students of one sex shall be comparable to the facilities provided for students of the other sex. Okay, why did they put that in? Because it wasn't that many years after Brown versus the Board of Education, when the Supreme Court had held that separate was inherently equal in the context of race. And they wanted to make sure that they had made the point that in the context of sex, that's not true. So they provided this exception. Note the exception is permissive. Although there is a deeply entrenched tradition in this nation to have separate public bathrooms for men and women, separate showers for men and women, it's not legally required. A school could, if it were crazy enough, decide that it was going to do it on the basis of astrological signs. They could do it on the basis of gender identity. That was the law as of the time of the transgender guidance in May of 2016. A school was banned from sex discrimination, but with a separate rule that says you can engage in separation of the sexes for these purposes of intimate facilities. So that means basically for that purpose, a school can do anything that isn't banned. So along comes the transgender guidance. And you know, in terms of what did Congress mean by the word sex, you just can't get there from here. You just can't. Gerald Ford signed this 1975 regulation into law. Do you really think that he was thinking of this? Clearly not. But what they were depending upon, what the Department of Education argues, and I hate to get a bit technical here. No, I don't. I love getting really technical, but I may lose a couple of you. There is a case called Price Waterhouse. And Price Waterhouse is actually an employment discrimination case. A woman who worked for Price Waterhouse accounting firm, she did not get a promotion. And her argument was that she didn't get the promotion because she has an aggressive personality. And her argument was that if she were a man with the same personality, that she would have gotten the promotion. And the Supreme Court looked at that and said, yeah, that's right, that's sex discrimination. If she were a man, all other things being equal, she'd have gotten the promotion. So they're trying to apply the same logic in Price Waterhouse to the bathroom situation, but it doesn't work. What they're saying is, if the Supreme Court case that's gonna be decided sometime this year is called Gloucester County School District versus Gigi. Gigi is a girl. But Gigi identifies as a boy. And Gigi is arguing, if I were an actual boy, if I were anatomically male, I'd be allowed to use the boys' room. Okay, that's true, that's true. But that proves too much, because that's true for all the girls. It has nothing to do with gender identity. If they were boys, they'd be able to use the boys' room, but they're not. And it sounds like, oh, well, that's kind of like Price Waterhouse, until you shake yourself and remember, but that's exactly what the rule covers. It says that that is the kind of separation that is permissible by law. So Price Waterhouse has nothing to do with this situation, and the Department of Education's reliance on Price Waterhouse is completely incorrect. That's what I have to say about the transgender guidance.
Thank you. There are all these sort of trickle-down effects from this Title IX stuff. So for instance, a little more than a year ago, the fall 2014 semester, I was a TA in a course on the ethics of war. And the professor had asked me, who would be a member of the class, to push back if the students were forming a consensus too quickly and to offer counterarguments. So toward the end of the class, I did this with regard to whether it was a good idea to have female Army Rangers. And I was subject to an investigation. I was accused of not harassment, even discrimination. You get a lot of the title of this office. It's the Office of Institutional Equity and Compliance. Like, the name is like a warm mafioso handshake. It's like, we're all equal and you're gonna do what we say, aren't you? And so, It's a kind of a long story, but eventually the department pushed back and said, what are you doing with this grad student of ours? And they squirted verbal ink and went away. But I don't know how often this happens. So that's one thing I want to ask about. And the other thing is, when I looked into this a couple of years ago, I looked at the justification for the Dear Colleague letter, I noticed that in principle, the sorts of arguments they give could be used for the legal system generally. There's nothing special about college campuses that justifies the preponderance of evidence standard. What the argument is that there are so many rape cases that are not being prosecuted, that need to be prosecuted, we just need to get a lot more convictions up. And if that's right, then that would have to apply to the legal system itself, it would seem to me, which would be a reductio ad absurdum. All right, thank you.
I need a microphone. On your experience as a TA, you said, yeah, I don't know how often these things happen. I don't know either, and that's what scares me. There's no way to tally up these. Sometimes stories leak out, sometimes they don't. And that's a very, very troubling fact. And I wish we knew more. Because there are a lot of academic freedom issues. What you were doing as a TA is exactly what TAs are supposed to be doing. What you were instructed to push back if the students seem to be arriving at a consensus too quickly, you know, that's exactly what teachers should do. And yet, we do know that there are cases like yours that have occurred. All I can say is academic freedom is not being appreciated fully. And it's important that we make an impression that academic freedom needs to be defended and that it's vital to education and things are out of hand.
Oklahoma Wesleyan was hesitant for one reason to get involved in this case that I described to you. Because obviously, as a conservative Christian institution, we still have rules with regard to sexual behavior on our campus. We still do have men's and women's dorms. We still do have restrictions as to how women can enter a men's dorm and how men can enter a women's dorm. We still do have an open door policy that during open hours, you've got to have the door open. We still stand by those standards because we think they make good sense and we actually have fewer of these problems rather than more as a result of those standards. Call me crazy. But I was hesitant to get involved in this particular case because I didn't want to be accused of defending the rapist. As far as I'm concerned, if he's guilty, hanging from the highest tree. That's what I've done for 20, 30 years in my profession. I help the girl go to the police and we say, go get him. And if you've got evidence, we're going to drag the guy down and he's going to be subject to that investigation and any of the consequences therein. But if he's not guilty, why in the world should he be dragged before a kangaroo court and all of his constitutional rights be violated? And if the girl doesn't want to make it a public issue in front of her peers, in front of the faculty, why should she be forced to do so? And why should we circumvent and contravene this entire process that's worked quite well, frankly? We don't need the government telling us how to handle it differently. But the fear was is that we would be accused of defending the rapist. And if you watch the confirmation hearings with DeVos, she's being accused of that because she gave $5,000 to fire. She's defending rapists. The only way to counter that, in my view, is to speak the truth and speak it boldly with confidence and courage and challenge the lunacy and the nonsense of the converse claim. Take the high road. Be pro-woman. Stand for her rights, her privacy, her dignity. Take the high road. Be pro-constitution. Stand for due process, freedom, and fairness. Force people to challenge you for doing those things, and I don't see how they can win.
This is probably an unanswerable question. It's really asking an opinion of the whole panel, probably Professor Heriot. Do you see, or fortunate with the new administration, I know it's just the first day, but people he's looking at bringing in, any chance that the lunacy will be rolled back up to and including the sports team lunacy, which still rankles me? I don't see how, I know Bush tried it and he ran for cover when the usual suspects went crazy. And I just want to say, I'm old enough, my freshman year in college, we had rules kind of like yours. But when they changed, it was really bad. So, thanks.
You're right, that's an unanswerable question. I don't want to speculate on what the Trump administration is likely to do. I'm sure we'll see some changes at the Department of Education, but I don't know which changes they will be, so I don't want to comment on that. Go ahead.
Well, I don't know that there's an answer to the question. I do think, I'll throw out another answer, and obviously I've got a little bit more of a confrontational style than some of you probably feel comfortable with. But I'm obligated to protect my institution. I'm also obligated to protect a worldview that I think is superior to those that are challenging it. So I don't apologize for entering into the public square and trying to do a good job, be forthright about it. But sometimes I think back to what Christ did in the face of controversy. He often asked a rhetorical question rather than entered into a debate or an argument. Now the guy is the incarnate Son of God. He's the smartest guy that ever walked the face of the earth. He could have won the debate. But he often chose just to ask the rhetorical question to force his adversaries to drop their stones and walk away. Maybe we should engage in similar strategies in confronting the lunacy. In the midst of the transgender mandate, I became so frustrated. And again, I could lose, but I throw out the rhetorical example or question. I became so frustrated, I said, okay, I'm getting so frustrated with this transgender mandate. I'm about ready. Our soccer team was ranked number one in the nation at the time. We have an exceptional men's soccer team. I said, I'm about ready to go pick 11 of my male soccer players, tell them to raise their hand this morning and claim that they're female. I'm going to put them on the field to compete in a women's game. And I'm going to force somebody to tell me no. We're going to kick your tail. We're going to beat you 20-0. I'm going to force you to tell me you can't do that. And I'm going to say, why? Why can't I do that? Which one of you is without the first stone? Why? Or which one of you wants to cast the first stone? Why can't I do that? And you're going to say, because they're not women. And I'm going to say, exactly my point. Exactly my point. That comment got more buzz than anything I've done other than not a daycare. And most of it was positive. Do they really want me to field 11 male soccer players? No. Because it's misogynistic and it's anti-woman to do so, and they know it. They will drop their stones.
I just wanted to emphasize the transgender guidance. All the press is about the bathroom, locker room, shower stuff, but it indeed covers athletics as well. They use somewhat more equivocal language, but it's only somewhat more. And you know, what's interesting is that, you know, who is the most famous transgendered person in the world right now? Who's Bruce Jenner? Not just a pretty good athlete, but like the best athlete of his era. And if that doesn't show, what would happen if Bruce Jenner, back when he was in high school, had decided he should be on the women's team?
He would have been the best female athlete ever.
He's the best male athlete, I mean, of that particular Olympics. I mean, the decathlon, that's the cool thing. It shows you can do everything. So it's almost a gift from God that's the poster child here. To know, you know, is there going to be a chance that somebody is going to be a really, really, you know, outstanding male athlete who will be way above any female athlete? Yes, there is that chance, because it actually has come to be.
In the last Olympics, it came to be. There was more than one athlete in the last Olympics that was genetically male who competed in female sports. That's a fact. Yeah, that's a fact.
They did.
And the women were silent because they felt intimidated, and they didn't want to speak up and be accused of being anti-LGBTQ. The political pressure resulted in the real women being quiet, and nobody came to their defense.
Here's another interesting fact. This is not a wholly left-right issue either. In the Gigi case, one of the amicus briefs filed was by an organization called WOLF. WOLF stands for the Women's Liberation Front. They are not conservatives. They are feminists. They consider themselves to be on the left, and they understand the threat this is to women's athletics and to women's privacy.
I think we have to end it there. Stay on schedule. But thank you to our panelists.